we can see really four channels of the way that secure land tenure and property rights have an importance for growth. The first one is this security channel. Investment leads to a flow of income, and that income stream needs to be protected against potential arbitrary expropriation or other threats through well-defined property rights, guaranteed or protected at some level by a government or some kind of social structure which will ensure the holder of those property rights that they can have the benefits that flow from the use of that property asset. This protection then provides this incentive to invest. Insecure property rights could mean that firms or individuals would lose or fail to realize the fruits or the gains from their investment and their efforts. The second main channel is efficiency. By being able to securely transact or trade land and property assets, those can be transferred from users which value them less or use them less efficiently to users who value them more and want to use them more efficiently, and therefore creating more of that process of maximization of the returns to land and property. The third channel really then is the reduction of protection costs. In a world in which society or government or some kind of social structure is not protecting property rights, it's costly for the holder of a piece of land to protect it. You think of images of people having to guard their property or having to fight off bandits or invaders or others who would seek to take that. So this is a reduction of the protection costs. And this is even into the modern era. We see in informal housing settlements in places like Peru, where people cannot feel they cannot leave to go to school or go to a job because of the need to stay in their informal dwelling to protect it from someone else potentially taking over. And the fourth channel is really then the facilitation of transactions and the link to financial markets. Formally defined property rights allow third parties like banks or financial institutions to feel secure that they can secure loans using the property asset as collateral. And that in turn creates the ability to raise additional money in financial markets. So I want to take a few minutes then to kind of look at these channels in a little more detail. I've taken what I think is a very nice graphic from a report by Locke, produced by ODI in 2013, on the theory of change, in which we have layers of the general economic context and then the intervention of strengthening property rights, and then this series of changes. And I think the first one, which is on the left-hand side of this slide, is really this idea of the security against expropriation. And so we see that having that security can lead to these kind of direct investment and labor effort effects. And we'll talk later in the presentation about where some of the documentation, the evidence that shows those things in the literature. And then basically out of higher investment and accumulation, that's driving higher per capita income. You can think of that, for example, in an agricultural situation through higher productivity in an agricultural crop, for example, leading to higher household income. We also have in the middle channel the idea of the ability to utilize land and property assets as collateral. And with that same then ability to take that that additional capital raised through collateral and apply it into new investment. You can think of a business utilizing that for something like new equipment to generate new business, or the same kind of agricultural example, to invest in new crops or higher value production, and with the outcome being some kind of higher income and at a society-wide level, economic growth, higher income per capita. And then we have the third channel being this facilitation of property transactions and efficiency through transactions. And there you can just imagine something like an unused property, like a vacant field, being sold or leased to a user who wants to and has the ability to use it more efficiently, and therefore that driving increased productivity of land and the other factors of production, labor and capital, also leading to this kind of increased household income and society-wide growth. And then I want to call attention, however, to some of the assumptions that underlie this kind of idealized set of channels or pathways working. We think about the assumptions that these rights are really will be protected across time, that they really do stand up. Often, the nature of that the institutions which are guaranteeing them will continue to do so and will be able to maintain them in the face of challenges like legal challenges or even things like conflicts or natural disasters. Often, I think there have been assumptions that private and formal titles do this the best, but I think that those assumptions are not necessarily borne out by global experience. I think, as we'll talk about a little later with Eleanor Ostrom's work, the important thing is that the rights are fully constructed and that they're socially legitimated, and that therefore they work to give people these incentives. I think in the collateral channel, the financial channel, there are also a lot of assumptions that need to be pointed out, that really that there is something like a financial system, like a banking system, that's available to make money and loans available using that collateral, and that that system is working well enough to be able to utilize the land or property asset. And then finally, I think, you know, there's really, it's important for these things to be seen as working across the whole economy to also take into consideration assumptions about the distribution of assets, land, and property in the economy. If the distribution is so unequal that that only a small group or a small subset of the society is able to benefit from this kind of chain, then it's unlikely that this sort of economy-wide growth can happen. So there needs to also be attention given to the overall distributional profile for these for this sort of theory of change to really be relevant to talk. I think then, as we really examine this theory of the relationship of land tenure and property rights with economic growth, we also need to be concerned with things, there are impediments that can get in the way of these type of processes and these positive capital accumulation and investment incentive and financial and efficiency effects from taking place, things that can impede these processes. And so certainly the badly defined or uncertain property rights go to the core of this. If I'm not sure that this asset really belongs to me or belongs to the group, it will be much harder to feel certain that investments and effort being put into it is really going to that one is going to get the benefit from that. And when I mean uncertain or poorly defined, the law does not define it, or there may be some vague historical sense of that this land belongs to someone or not, but that there's not, or it may simply be a completely unclear situation. Transaction costs are another type of impediment. If to get these kind of efficiency effects that we've been discussing, the transaction itself of selling or leasing or inheriting or gifting a piece of property need to be low enough that it makes sense to do it, and that it and that the gains from that transaction will still really be worth it. And this is not trivial in many parts of the world where different procedures, different permissions, different approvals and requirements drive the cost of that transaction up. There can also be tax and charges put onto transactions which have that same effect. We can also worry about information asymmetries, which is meaning that one party in the transaction may know a lot more about the real potential of the property than the other. And we also have to worry, I think, as an impediment about wealth asymmetries, particularly in things like agricultural land. The very wealthy parties may have the ability to bargain much more effectively, to borrow money more effectively than other parties, and end up dominating transactions, end up dominating markets in a way that impedes these kind of efficiency and economic growth effects that we're discussing. And then finally, the institutional structure of markets. If the land market is set up in a way, for example, that that certain groups, certain social groups, are typically don't participate or can't participate on an equal footing with others, then these type of, even if they're the most efficient users of land or may have a strong desire and ability to utilize that land, they still may not be able to acquire it. So these are the kind of impediments that that crop up all over the world. I want to also mention that the neoclassical view tends to downplay some of the issues about historical allocations and distributions, and the in a sense, the starting point where different rights have come from. And we sometimes see, in for example, in some certain post-colonial contexts, where there have been very unequal distributions of land historically that are now structuring land rights and land markets in a way that make it hard for these kind of efficiency effects to take place. The neoclassical view tends to want to think that markets will manage that, that if small but entrepreneurial and productive farmers exist within a context of historical large farms, that they will be able to bid and to offer to pay more for that land. They'll be able to compete in the land market. But as we've seen from some of these assumptions and from some of these impediments, there are also reasons associated with those historical allocations that may make that very difficult. And this gets then to some of the use of policies in the developing world to try to counteract or remedy the effect of some of those historical misallocations. And I think that we've seen all over the world in different times and places policies of land reform which seek to redistribute land, particularly underutilized land assets, in order to put whole economies onto the kind of pathway that we're talking about, in which these positive land utilization, land market effects can manifest themselves. And we could just say then that really these different distributions of assets can quite powerfully influence the growth trajectories and the allocation and distribution of wealth as economies evolve. And that has been the justification for different land reforms throughout history.